Charlotte Brown on my TV. Christmas time is here again, my friend. When I was a child, I thought that's all.
to us once more. Take it, y'all. Jesus Christ is born, Jesus Christ is born. Let all of heaven and earth rejoice on this Christmas morn. Jesus Christ is born, the Savior of the world. Let all of heaven and earth rejoice, Jesus Christ is born. And the prophet spoke the word. That word was spread throughout the land. Prepare the way of the Lord. And the angels told the shepherds. And the shepherds bowed to pray. Then the angels and the shepherds and the wise men sang this song on Christmas Day. They were singing, Jesus Christ is born. Jesus Christ is born. Let all of heaven and earth rejoice on this Christmas morn. Christ is born, the Savior of the world. Let all of heaven and earth rejoice, Jesus Christ is born. Stories and the Bible brought the truth. That preacher spoke those words to me, and I'm saying it to you. Oh, Jesus Christ is born. Jesus Christ is born. Let all of heaven and earth rejoice on this Christmas morn. Cause he died upon the cross and he conquered death and sin. Is born, Jesus Christ is born. Let all of heaven and earth rejoice on this Christmas morn. Jesus Christ is born, the Savior of the world. Let all of heaven and earth rejoice. Jesus Christ is born. Let all of heaven and earth rejoice. Jesus Christ is born. Our deliverer would come,
promised by the prophets, a Savior God's song. Through the silence of centuries, we waited for him to be born of a virgin in Bethlehem. Come and see what our God has done. Song. Glory in the highest. Yeah.
Just a tiny nowhere town with a tiny no room in. This is where the greatest story ever told begins. Where just a tiny beating heart had all creation leaning in. That night the world forever changed because of Bethlehem. It's where a star led to a stable, a baby's cry made angels sing, and the search to find a savior led to heaven's humble king. Where the wise men found the answer, the shepherds found the lamb, and I found my Emmanuel because of Bethlehem. Love is born, hope is here, heaven's light has made the darkness disappear. To a father's right hand throne, and a promise he's preparing us, a place we'll soon call home. He who came to earth from heaven is coming back again, and our eyes will see eternity because of Bethlehem. Of Bethlehem.
A soldier with no armor, in the middle of the battle, I was broken. I was broken.
Hey, good morning, everyone. We're glad you're here this morning. Joanne's going to begin us with our prelude this morning. Thank you, Joanne. Thanks, Joanne. Hey, welcome. We're glad you guys are here today. If you are joining us online, thanks for clicking the link. We are taking steps to make it more participatory for our online guests. And Marshall's actually over here off to my left, and he's on the computer this morning. And so if you have comments that you want to make or prayer requests, we invite you to do that. Just a reminder, as you come in, be sure to sign the attendance pads. It's always helpful to know who's here. So, and I don't know how you'll respond to this, but I have decided for the remainder of Advent not to tell any more dad jokes. So, now, see, that we would have to call it Sadvent because you're so sad about that. Or Dadvent, you know, if we kept going. So, you got to admit, the groaners are special. So, anyhow, it is the season of Advent, and we've got people here to, Deb Howell is here. She's going to come and light our Advent candle and do our reading, and actually, I'm going to light it for her, and she's going to read in prayer. Thank you.
Today, on the third Sunday of Advent, we light the joy candle from Matthew chapter 11, verses 8 and 9. What then did you go out to see? Someone dressed in soft robes? Look, those who wear soft robes are in royal palaces. What then did you go out to see? A prophet. Yes, I tell you, and more than a prophet. Let us pray. Dear God, you are the ultimate source of joy in this shadow-filled world. Make us nooks and beacons of the same joy. Carry our feet to the furthest reaches so that we might extend your warmth to everyone we meet. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you, Deb.
And we start off all of our worship services the same way. So if you will join me, and I'll say, love is God. And all the time.
Love is God.
Yeah. I know we have a few announcements this morning. Thank you. Yeah, Sarah, go ahead. Yeah.
Good morning. I wanted to remind you, in case you haven't had a chance to see it, but we have our auction that is wrapping up today. It is our youth fundraiser. It is one of our biggest fundraisers of the year, and we really appreciate those who have donated baskets and those who are bidding on it. We're going to feature number 50 this morning. It is a pasta basket with gourmet pasta and gourmet sauces and a gift card for whatever else you want to add, plus some other amazing things. So it'll be back there, as well as lots of other things. So the auction closes at 1 p.m., so be sure to get your bids in. In addition, we have another fundraiser happening in January. This is how we completely support youth ministry, right? And this one's going to be really fun. It's called The Great Night Out, and this is a chance to come and listen to a real comedian, not Chris. You walked into that one, I'm sorry. We'll have some mocktails and appetizers and childcare, and we are charging a ticket price. And we're hoping we'll get 100 people in the building for this event so that we can actually make it a really great fundraiser. So if you have friends, neighbors, colleagues, you want to make a party of it, sign up. The sign-up is online, and we hope to see you there, January 19th.
Marshall.
I had to look around to see if John was here because I wanted to say it wasn't going to be John Deardorff either, but it would have been much more fun if he'd have been here to say that. I may save that for next week. Hey, a few things. Thursday night, the 21st, it's our darkest night service. It starts at 7. I told you last week we've expanded this to be more than just about those who've lost, had a friend or family member die in the past year. It's about more just the experience of the season where we can just stop, take a deep breath, remember all the junk that's going on, but remember why it is we celebrate the season too. So if you'd like to come be a part of that, please do. Also, next Sunday, if you wait until 10:30 to come to church, you're going to be here just in time for the Christmas carols. because the rest of the service is going to start at 10. So for y'all that come to this service, if you want to try to get the premium donuts, you know, come at 9:30 and join us for that. That'll be in the morning. Then at 4 o'clock we'll have the family service, and then 5 to 6 will be communion come and go service, and then 10 o'clock will be the candlelight service that we know and love. So come be a part of those things if you can. Martin Luther King celebration weekend this year is really early. It's like the second full weekend in January. So they'll have the teach-in all day Saturday and the unity service on Sunday night. On Monday, they've traditionally had a luncheon in which they've got a speaker who's come in. The speaker this year, I've forgotten her name, but I know she's a member of the United Church of Christ, and she's been working on their national board with race and justice issues. She was in St. Louis in the time of the Ferguson riots and all of that, so it's been on the ground with all those things. She's going to be speaking. I hear she's dynamic. If you'd like to come, join us. We have a table. We need more people to sit there. So if you'd like to come be a part of that, let me know. I'll let you know how much tickets are, and we'll go from there. I think that's all the announcements I have.
Right. Oh, tables?
Tables. Oh, yeah. After. If you've got time and the energy after the service today, we're going to move the little square tables out. Because for the Darkest Night Circle service, we're going to set up a small circle for that. For the rest of the time, we're going to be setting up the rows, like we usually have, and getting ready for Christmas Eve. So if you can help, please do. We'll just carry them over into the great room.
I'll just remind you of one quick thing. We are still, we're still inviting you guys to bake cookies as a way to bless first responders. If you do, we're not collecting them here, but this Thursday and Friday, Bethel Synagogue is collecting them. So if you bake some cookies, take them over to Bethel and drop them off there. The hours, I think, are on the screen in the announcement to do that. So it would be a blessing. So. Hey, thank you, Bells. Will you join with me in the words of our opening prayer? It's on the screen or in the bulletin. Love, whom I call God, you welcome me into this time of worship and remind me that this world, this place, and this moment belong to you. You welcome me as a traveler on a journey I do not always want or understand. You ask me to feed the hungry, clothe the naked, and comfort those who mourn. O God, I ask that as I learn and grow and attempt to serve you and others, I will be given the grace to love you and my neighbor in all that I do. I pray that at the end of each day, I can say to those to whom love is a stranger, will have found in each of us. All right, we're going to sing. The hymn number is 211, and it's in your hymnal and on the screen. O come, Emmanuel. And stand up as you're able or desire to, and let's sing. Hey, you may be seated. So we get a chance every week to share about the good things that are happening in our lives, the celebrations and the things that have just brought joy. So, all right, I'm going to sneak by here.
Well, I have to say this on behalf of Barb Bradley, who I don't see here this morning, because today is Margaret Bradley's 94th birthday.
Wow.
So
all
she's
right.
Got a lot of family in town, and I'm sure she's preoccupied with those activities. Yeah. And Barb Bradley and I, that Barb, she's everywhere, isn't
she?
She love
is.
That lady. Anyway, she and I served our 12th Habitat breakfast and lunch yesterday to the guys.
Wow.
And we got the luxury of being in a home that is basically done. All that needs is cleaning. So when I took my cinnamon rolls, I baked them there. So the house got initiated, smelled like cinnamon rolls. Barb made the most delicious chili, so then the whole house smelled like her chili when she brought that. It was just a wonderful day. We both got most heartfelt hugs. It was just a wonderful day.
That's great. I need to visit that house. Hey, who else? Yeah, Shirley.
My second granddaughter graduated from Wayne State with her bachelor's, and she's planning to start her master's program in January, also at Wayne State. Because of COVID, she has an extra year of soccer eligibility, so she's going to stay there. And one of my youngest granddaughters is picking up the story of Christmas. She just mentioned that how she learned Jesus went to the farm to get all the babies.
That's great. That's great. Thank you. Hey, yeah.
On that same note, our granddaughter and her husband both graduated from UNO this week.
Great. Congratulations to them. Anybody else? Yeah.
I'm going to embarrass my family, but I see my daughter and her husband here and five of the six grandsons today. Great. I really appreciate it.
Yeah. Great. Fantastic. Welcome. Any other good things that have happened recently? Okay. Hey, any concerns in the community that we have or things that we just need to remember? Marshall, anything online?
No.
All right. All right. Take a few breaths and try to get settled in your seat, and we'll center ourselves here and pray. Lord Christ, we pause for a moment. We remember you. We remember our place in this world, and we remember that we are not alone here. We share it with our neighbors. We share this life, this planet. We share this community together. And we remember that you, God, are the one who has generated this life and given it to us as truly a gift of joy, so that we could not only live here, but live together, live in an inclusive way, live in a way of contagious joy. But God, we know because we've lived here long enough that it is not a place of joy for everyone. And so today we remember neighbors far and wide, neighbors close, and we seek to include them and to remember them in our prayers. We remember the hope and the potential that you have placed in each of us to be agents of loving in our world. We remember that we live between two poles. Poles of joy and happiness and celebration, and poles of sorrow and suffering. And somewhere in there, infused is grace. Grace that includes and welcomes and keeps us on the path. And today we remember that path. A path of love, a path of mercy, a path of welcoming. And we remember your Son who first walked this path and who teaches us how to walk it, as we remember the words that he prayed, "Our Father, Lord in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever." Hey. We have a chance to just watch a short little Advent video. So I'm just going to direct your attention to the screen. And Brian, if you would go ahead and play that. Thank you.
Let us receive the King. Let us receive the King.
Hey, if you guys didn't know that, that was actually a lot of the children. They were downstairs in the children's space, and that was their way of blessing you and sending Advent greetings. So I think you guys are up again. Yeah, thank you. Thank you, Bells. Hey, as you get a minute, stand up and greet one another. Doesn't matter how you do it. Shake a hand, give a Christmas high five, whatever it is. Pass the peace of Christ to one another.
To you.
How are you?
Great.
All right. Hey, as we're heading back to our seats, Mary Jo Jeffers is going to read our scripture today. I think you win the prize. This is one of the longer ones, so. But come on up and read for us. Thank you. Thank you.
Is this turned on?
It will be.
Oh, okay. Good morning. Isaiah 61, 4, 1 through 4 and 8 through 11. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because the Lord has anointed me. He has sent me to bring good news to the oppressed, to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives, and to release the prisoners, to proclaim a year of the Lord's favor and the day of vengeance for our God, to comfort all who mourn, to provide for those who mourn in Zion, to give them a garland instead of ashes, and the oil of gladness instead of mourning, the mantle of praise instead of a faint heart. They will be called oaks of righteousness, the planting of the Lord to display his glory. They shall build up the ancient ruins. They shall raise up the former devastations. They shall repair the ruined river cities and the devastations of many generations. For I, the Lord, love justice. I hate robbery and wrongdoing. I will give faithfully to their recompense. I will make an everlasting covenant to them. Their descendants, shall be known among the nations, and their offspring to the peoples. All who see them shall acknowledge that they are the people whom the Lord has blessed. I will greatly rejoice in the Lord. My whole being shall exult in my God, for he hath clothed me in the garments of salvation. He has covered me in the robe of righteousness. As the bridegroom decks himself with a garland, and the bride adorns herself with jewels. As for the earth brings forth its shoots, and the garden causes what is sown in it to spring up, so the Lord God will cause righteousness and praise to spring up before all nations. Hear what the Spirit of the Lord is saying to the church.
Pardon me while I get a little room to work. Mary Jo, thank you. I'm not sure how it is that we work it out so that you get the longest readings every time, but yeah, that's true too. And Madeline gets long. Maybe we just need to, I'll find the short reading lectionary next time. Jesus wept. We have a volunteer. Okay. So, we're going to do so. This scripture from Isaiah becomes important to the Gospels because it's like this backdrop to the story. When the people who are writing the Gospels were trying to figure out how to explain the experience that they had had with Jesus and what they thought they were being called to do by him, one of the ways they understood it was to look back into the scriptures they knew and try to see how it made sense. And Isaiah is one of them that gets pulled out a lot because Isaiah is preaching to the people of Israel at a time in which, sometimes we read from Isaiah, it says, you know, comfort my people, says your God, for they have, and cry to Jerusalem, she has served double. She has served double for all that she has done. It's this time in their lives when, back then, when things were not going right, and Isaiah was saying, just wait a moment. There'll be a time when because our God loves justice, because our God cares about how it is we live with each other. Isaiah had this vision that being the people of God was more than just about ethnicity. It was about the way you lived with each other. And when they saw what they were being called, Jesus was calling them to do, they looked back and saw Isaiah and said, this makes sense. This makes sense. And they began to use it. It gets scattered throughout the Gospels in different ways. We'll maybe find them in the future, and I'll try to pull them out more for you. That's kind of the sermon comes in two different parts. The next part of the sermon comes because, the last time I was preaching, I stood up here and I said to all of you who are up here that I thought Jesus had a human father. Okay, It's just one step. If I tell you I don't believe in the virgin birth, then there's only one other option, right? And Karen Williams, who comes to the 9 o'clock service, you know, during the time right afterwards, came right up to me and she says, so now what do I do? What do I do with Mary's yes? What do I do with Mary's yes? Now let me check. You know my family. But I need to find out who else I can kind of talk to. How many of you have either grown up in, hung out a lot with Catholic families? All right. So, all right. I just, because what I didn't know, what I had to think through during the week was, well, how much of this is something that I know about because I hang out with Catholic families, or how much of it is because I just hang out at church? And how many of you might understand where I'm coming from. In Mary has been lifted up within our tradition and other denominations because she is one of the women in the Bible that we can look to as an example of faith, as one of those heroes of our faith. And lots of times it comes because of this particular passage. Let me find where I put it, right here. This is the scripture sometimes that we use when we think of how Mary responds in faith to what she's called. This is how it goes. It's out of the book of Luke. It starts with the 26th verse, goes to the 38th. In the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent by God to a town in Galilee called Nazareth. To a virgin engaged to a man whose name was Joseph of the house of David. The virgin's name was Mary. And he came to her and said, greetings, favored one, the Lord is with you. But she was very much perplexed by his words and pondered what sort of greeting this might be. The angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God, and now you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you will name him Jesus. And he will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High, and the Lord God will give to him the throne of his ancestor David. He will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and his kingdom there will be no end." Mary said to the angel, "How can this be? I'm a virgin." And the angel said to her, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. Therefore, the child to be born will be holy. He will be called Son of God. And now your relative Elizabeth, in her old age, has also conceived a son. And this is the sixth month for who was said to be barren. For nothing will be impossible with God." Then Mary said, "Here am I, the servant of the Lord. Let it be with me according to your word." "Here am I, the servant of the Lord. Let it be with me according to your word." Then the angel departed from her. Amen. Now, the reason I got the stool out is every once in a while I get into one of these sermons and one of two things happen. Either I've thought about it, and every time I think about it, it comes out a different way, so I'm not sure, so I figure I better sit down in case I get lost in the middle of the sermon. And other times, I want us to be able to take just a little bit of time. See, here's the problem. I can go through the Gospels. I can go through the infant stories with you, and we can talk about them, and I can put them in context, and I can show you how those stories, the way they're told in the moment when they're comparing them to what's going on with the Romans living in the land, how it is people might have seen Jesus' story to be different, and that the infant narratives are like a big introduction to the Gospels that they are a part of. I can do all of that, and I can stand up here and say, "I don't believe in the virgin birth, but here's why it's important." I can, and we might, you may not totally agree, but we can come to some sort of nodding understanding with each other about what that is. But what I can't do is tell you who your faith and religious heroes should be. And I am reluctant to take Mary out of that mix. Because what is she saying yes to? What is she saying yes to? If this isn't a magical miracle of God, what is she saying yes to? I thought about it a bunch and wondered, you know, what do any of us as parents say yes to when we first find out that we're going to be parents? I think maybe Elizabeth actually had a more difficult time than Mary had, right? Because Mary's, at least we assume she's young. You know, I don't know if she's a teenager. I don't know if she's in her 20s. What we do know by the story is that Elizabeth is old. She might even be 50. She might be old. We don't know. That's a joke. Come on. But think about it. I don't know what the age is when the experience of chasing a toddler around goes from fun to totally exhausting. Right? There's a moment when you can't keep up. And we have said to each other, I've heard it said to others that, you know, thank God you have your kids when you're young. That doesn't always work that way, but they're just busy. So maybe Elizabeth is the one that we understand her experience better. But there's Mary. And another reason it gets so hard is because Remember a couple weeks ago when I described to you sometimes that the work of our spiritual lives is like being people who walk into a room in which somebody has created a mess, and we realize that we're the adults who have to clean it up because whoever was there and made the mess is no longer around, and now we have to do it. One of the messes that has been created and still gets created is that the church has done a crappy job, and crappy is a theological term, it's specific, has done a crappy job of lifting up the faith of women in scripture and in church tradition as something that can be something that can be lived out. We have not lifted that up. We've not figured it out. And so what we've done is we've focused a lot of attention on Mary. And we've created the Midrash around her. Midrash is a Jewish term that says we've made up stories. We call them church tradition to help us understand who she was and what she was going through and what her family was like around her. We've created these things we can't find in Scripture because we have the questions that five-year-olds in VBS have. Why? How come? Well, who were her parents? How did that work? All of those things. And yet we've raised her up in such a way that, well, I would suggest to you that for the most part, all of you are really glad that your parents and your grandparents didn't always remain a virgin. Right? Yeah. And so to lift up somebody else, to put Mary on that pinnacle and said, that's the ultimate of being human, is nothing any of the rest of us can have in our experience. Because to be human and have kids, we can't do both. We can't do both. And so what do we do? I would suggest that we reflect in our own lives about who it is that informs us as people of faith. Who is it that we try to live up to and be like? Now, guys, sit with me a bit, because I can say out loud in total honesty and total belief that I think over time the voice of men has been raised too loudly within the choir of human experience and spiritual practice. In other words, we got to tell our stories a lot more than women got to tell their stories, right? We got to figure out how to deal with that. Now, as I say that, I know that there's a part of me that says, whew, that's good. Let them tell their own story. I don't care. I'm just going to sit right back here. In fact, we've done it enough that the joke is that if it ain't for the women, nothing gets done in church. I can see some of you are going, that ain't a joke. That's the way it is. And yet, we can't do that. Because our voices, our experiences, our understanding of the flaws in the past but bringing it forward means that now we are part of a theological mixed chorus of faith. That we tell all our stories, and we tell them in relationship to each other. And guys, you know, sometimes I think we set a little far back. I say that because of things like when we try to find Sunday school teachers, I know that most of the time we're asking a woman. Because guys get really glazed over looks on their faces when they think Sunday school, little kids, a bunch of them all at once in the same place, and they quit imagining. And we got to stop that. We have to work through that. Because our voice and experience needs to be heard, and it needs to be heard in a new way. And for women, I try not to say we, and I certainly can't say I, and when I talk to women, I can't say either of those. I don't know. I don't know which voices you want to begin to lift up and follow and tell stories about and see yourself like. Maybe it is Elizabeth. Maybe it is a woman of faith who finds herself in a situation she could never imagine, but and yet is willing to walk forward and do all that she can in love to share life without the pregnancy. Okay? Maybe it's like Abraham's wife, Sarah, who all of a sudden finds out they're moving. Do you notice when God asks people, you know, he says to Mary, we say Mary said yes. She really didn't have anything to agree to. God just said, by the way, I need to tell you, this is going to happen. And she could decide whether or not to be faithful with it, in with it, or not. Same with Abraham and Sarah. Same with all the others. That the call of God sometimes is to have faith even in the middle of an experience that we're going to have anyway. It's going to happen. Are you going to live through it with faith, or are you going to find yourself in the midst of despair? And in the midst of your despair, are you still going to have faith? That becomes a question. So, for this week, in the next couple weeks, I want you to think about who are the people in your life, or who are the people that you've read about and know that way, that you find to be your spiritual mentor, the one you try to aspire to be. Now, because I'm the preacher and I get to do these things, I'm going to look at you and say, you cannot say your mom, dad, or your Sunday school teacher. I believe those people can be that for you. I just want you to think beyond and not just go, dad. Because my dad has to go in that list for me. But I need to think beyond that. Maybe it's a character you've learned about in the Old Testament. Maybe it's somebody you work beside. Maybe it's somebody you've heard their story in the last few years because they are a contemporary to you. I don't know. But find them. Think about them. And live them out. I know one of mine on my Mount Rushmore of figures that I will follow is Jacob. Because he wrestles with God all the time. And in the end, he's still a knucklehead. I can identify with that. I know that. For you, it might be somebody else. But as you think about it, hear for their blessing in your life as you live out the faith you've been called to. Amen. We're going to sing. And then we got some time. We'll come back and we'll add stuff to that sermon. We are singing the first three verses of 203, Hail to the Lord's Anointed. If it's comfortable, stand. If it's not, stay seated.
Thank you.
be seated. Are there any questions or things we need to add? I wasn't going to throw it. What's that?
You were talking about the Catholics.
Yeah.
And they do praise Mary very highly.
Yeah.
They regard her very highly. Is it because she was the mother of Jesus or because it was a virgin birth?
Yes.
To both? Really?
Yeah. Okay. Well, yeah. I barely understand my own tradition, let alone... Yeah, and since I guess I get to spend Christmas with more Catholics than Methodists, that makes me an expert. But I think it's both. I think one of the things that other traditions have done, maybe better than we have at times, is to find those people of faith and lift them up to a level in which we can begin to see our lives in their life and see their life in ours, so that we have a way to live that out. Now, we can go to confirmation and sort that all out. But I think it's a bit of both. But like all things of faith, I can find five Catholics and get six opinions on the role of Mary in the church. I might want to handpick the five, but I can do it. Other questions? I'm going to go back to my lineup. Come on.
If you don't believe that Mary is a virgin, then how do you explain the liturgy after, I read it a couple weeks ago, where Joseph said yes to being with Mary, even though she was pregnant by the Holy Spirit?
Right. So what do you do with that part of the story? Well, I'm going to come at Scripture as if it is inspired and holy story that is written to express and explain an experience that people have already had. In order for the story to be told, they needed Joseph to be able to have that conversation. Now, trivia question for you. How many words do you think Joseph gets to say in the first two chapters of the book of Luke? One? None. That story of the Holy Spirit coming, of the angel coming to Joseph and saying, "Hey, Joseph, it's okay, calm down." It ain't in Luke. In Luke, the people who talk are, for the most part, are the women. And in fact, Zechariah, the dad of John the Baptist, he gets to talk only after he's been mute for 9 months, all right? Because as soon as he finds out that, apparently it was quite shocking to him to find out that his wife Elizabeth was going to be pregnant, because he lost his voice until they took John the Baptist to dedicate him at the temple. That's when he got his voice back. So it's as if the entire start of the book of Luke is asking us to listen to voices we don't usually listen to. Asking us to hear things we don't normally pay attention to.
Thanks for your comments about the voices of women. And I'm just curious, in the Jewish faith, it made me think of it with the cookies that are being collected at Bethel, and it's the Miriam group that is doing that there. Who are the women in the Old Testament that are heroes, that are brought up in that faith as voices to hear?
Oh, this is a pop quiz I'm supposed to give you, not me. Well, I could preach a sermon starting with Eve as a voice that needs to be heard, all the way to all the wives of the patriarchs. And, you know, there's Sarah and Rebecca, and help me out, those of you who remember these things better than I. You know, Ruth. Yeah, Ruth, Esther, Naomi. Who was, help me out, Barb, who was the woman who the general of the opposing evil army came to her and said, you know, I'm running away from the guys, they're trying to kill me, give me some food and let me take a nap? And she said, sure. And as soon, she said, sure, and as soon as he fell asleep, she drove a tent peg through his head. Some of the women are a little, you don't want to mess with them, all right? There's a ton, and I don't know them all, but they're there. The my opinion, the sin of Christian tradition is that we have to go back and look for them, that we don't just have them at the tip of our tongue. Even for me, we don't just go, well, here, this is the list. That we have to stop and think. Yeah.
There's a great book called Women of the Bible.
Yeah.
And you learn a lot about, especially the Old Testament.
Yeah. There's a book called Women of the Bible, and yeah, you learn a lot about them. I would say that some of that is people are filling stuff in and around that is their opinion. But, okay. You'll sort through that. Others? It's like telling the story out of the New Testament about Mary Magdalene, Martha, the women that Paul would go and do ministry with. Paul called them deacons. He called them, the word became deacons. And then it was in English where we had to separate deacons into deaconess. All right? And all of a sudden, deacon could stand in the pulpit and the deaconess had to be in the kitchen. But Paul said they were deacons, that they had the voice. That's what happened in history. That we took their voice away, even when the experience at the time was people who were equal. Now again, I've messed up that room a little bit. I walked into the room and it was a lot messed up before I got there. Our job as adults in faith is to get into the room and straighten it out as much as we can, knowing that we will never ever get it all done. And we'll pass it on to the next group. The volleyball game has not yet started. Don't worry. We'll sing, we'll say the benediction. Sing shalom, and then listen to the post-lead. Join with me. Now, let us go in peace to live a faith that matters, to grow in the love of God, and to serve wherever we are led. Amen.